I wonder what's on TV.
Hell no.
Welcome.
I've got something. I've got something. I'll
share with you. Share with you.
Tonight on our show, we'll bring you an artist profile, Miss Izzy, a record review, and much, much more.
Animation artist Michael D. Pettijohn studied his craft as a graduate from the Philadelphia College of Art. His independent works include the short film Someday, which was featured in the AIVF 10th Anniversary Reel, which was shown at the New York Museum of Modern Art. Michael's eclectic interest in science fiction, jazz and avant-garde music, and modern cutting-edge animated works such as Fritz the Cat, Duck Amuck, and Heavy Metal are the inspiration for his personal animated creations. We're here with Michael Pettijohn, animation artist. What made you want to do animation? What is it about the art form that you like?
Well, let's face it, it's a magical art form. You know, you bring graphics or whatever to life. You make it move, you make it jump, you make it glow. In other words, you're giving life or the illusion of life to something that otherwise would just be sitting there.
You're influenced a lot by science fiction. Is your animation science fiction based?
Some of my personal stuff, yes.
What is it you like about science fiction?
Well, not even the sky is the limit. You know, the edge of the universe, if need be, or for that matter, the microverses between the atoms of this table, this beverage here, for that matter, you could dive into it. Just by being shrunken down to a period point, and all of a sudden, this becomes an ocean. And who knows what adventures lie within.
One of your films was shown at MoMA. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
It was based on an Arthur C. Clarke short story called If I Forget Thee, O Earth. It had to do with a post-nuclear war scenario. A story of a lunar colony that happened to be isolated because of the war. And what I focused on was the thought of a rite of passage, the birthday of a young man and his grandfather taking him out an EVA for the first time. The idea that when you go outside for the first time, it's a rite of passage. You look at the earth, and in the story, the idea that as you would look at the dark side of the earth and you would see these glowing spots, these were where cities were, now glowing radioactive ash heaps.
As an artist, what are your goals?
Well, to borrow a quote from a film that influenced me when I was young, Easy Rider, I'd like to do my own thing in my own time.
Okay, we'll take you to Someday, an animation piece by Michael Pettijohn.
Up and at 'em, son. Never been outside before, have you?
Nope.
Well, now you're really gonna see something. Happy birthday. And now, if you'll turn around, you'll see what was our home. Well, home like an island in this old universe. And man thought he was smarter than God with his technology. But it got him. And now we can't go home again.
Maybe we can go later.
Someday. Maybe. Maybe someday.
For more information on any of the artists featured in tonight's show, go to www.theimperialorgy.com/outsider/.
That's just not funny.
No! No!
People are saying...
And here's some more with behind it.
Yeah.
Oh my God!
People are saying... At an Orgy Halloween performance at Webster Hall in New York City, Caeser and crew began to get a little out of control with the help of two of the nice young ladies from Bikini Contest. Bikini Contest, who were dressed as the Dead Spice Girls for the Hallows Eve, started the night with a fun-filled set that included a dead posh spice giving birth on stage. The crowd was chanting, "Push! Push!" Once the Imperial Orgy took the stage, it seems that Pink was having a simultaneous exhibitionistic soiree with Dead Baby Spice and Dead Scary Spice, both of whom joined the orgy on stage. Events started innocently enough with some less vicious bumps and grinds from the darling little angels, but by night's end, the naughty girls and Mr. Can't Keep It In His Pants Pink were laying on stage mid-song, smooching it up and rolling on top of each other with embarrassing abandon. People are saying that the refined ladies and gentlemen in the audience of Webster Hall also seem to have lost their manners and were soon rolling about the stage as if they were taking part in a lewd loving. In the middle of the fetid frolics, one young lass yelled out, "This is the best night of my life. Honey, you need to get out more." And even the club's sexy DJ left the post behind the turntable to join the bad behavior on stage. When Pink was asked how he felt about the oh-so-odd goings-on with the Dead Spice Girls, he replied with a half-smile, "I never knew necrophilia could be so much fun."
And now, get ready for an underground film.
Hi, my name's Nina. Sure, I'm a famous rock star now, but let me tell you how it all started. I was living with my three pinhead stepbrothers and my jerk stepdad. If you thought my name was bad, check out my stepbrothers. Rex, Pip, and Chaz. They were in this metal band called Los Lone Rangers, and they never got any gigs besides their friends' parties. So why did I hang around? Well, I mean, they did get to go to parties, and some of their friends were kinda cute. I would always ask to go with, and they always said,
"Maybe you can go if you put the equipment in the van."
I was such a sucker. I loaded that van a million times, thinking this time they'll let me go. And they always left without me. And it hurt, you know? I'd go to my room and cry. My stepdad will always yell up at me,
"Shut the hell up!"
I stopped crying and just talked to my teddy bear. I'd tell him how my stepdad sucks, and I wished I could get out of there and be a rock star. So one day I'm sitting there talking to my teddy bear, and this voice responds,
"Nina, you shouldn't cry. Today you can go to the party."
I looked around and asked who's there.
"I am your fairy godfather, and I am going to make you a rock star,"
the voice responded. I was like, "Yeah, all right, how are you going to pull that one?" And he said,
"With magic, of course."
So he whipped out his magic wand and changed my teddy bear to a chauffeur. He changed my bed to a limo, and he changed my clothes, too. He warned me,
"Make sure you're back by midnight,"
and said,
"Go and enjoy yourself."
When I got to the party, Los Lone Rangers were already playing. But the weirdest thing happened. The crowd parted and let me walk right up to the front. Before I knew it, I was in front of the microphone singing. The crowd went wild. I mean, they liked me. They really liked me. I sang all night without looking at the time. The crowd was yelling for an encore when the clock struck 12. I ran to the limo, but it was too late. I was so upset I couldn't move. I just sat there, petrified. Turns out Trent Reznor was in the crowd. He followed me when I left.
"Don't cry, miss,"
he said.
"You are magnificent. My name is Trent."
As if I didn't know.
"And I'm a record producer. I want to sign you."
I couldn't believe it. He walked over to me and put his arm on my shoulder. And he said,
"I'll sign you, but not the band."
I was ecstatic. I threw my arms in the air and shouted, "Thank you, fairy godfather."
Well, Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, man of nature.
Caeser Pink's obsessive lifelong study of cultural anthropology, mythology, comparative religions, and Jungian psychology have led him to create a theory of mystical and sexual union that infuses the imperial orgy's art and philosophy.
Throughout the history of mankind, religion and sexuality have always been combined. Whether it's in fertility orgies, in the fields of ancient Europe, to ensure an abundant harvest, or the graphic sexual images on ancient Hindu temples, or the provocative sexual language used by Catholic saints in rapture and in Southern gospel hymns, the connection between sexuality and religious fervor is embedded deep in our unconscious minds and still strikes a powerful chord in modern man.
Based on his studies, Caeser uses powerful archetypal imagery to sexually excite his audiences and subtle methods of crowd psychology to manipulate them into letting down their inhibitions and taking part in the orgy event. Caeser at times believes himself to be possessed by a spirit representing the masculine side of nature's sexual polarity, a spirit which in different cultures throughout history has been known by many different names. In the song Oak King Blues, the spirit speaks through Caesar's body as it searches for its female counterpart hidden within the women in the audience.
With horns and fur I'll rise tonight.
The effect of this sexual tension on fans is sometimes extraordinary. When the Imperial Orgy first took the stage in rural Pennsylvania, people seemed to be mesmerized.
You have to keep in mind that our first show was at this little ballroom dive where cover bands would hack out top 40 and the audiences would basically just ignore the musicians. But our show was was unbelievable. The bar was so small that it didn't even have a stage, but people treated us like we were rock stars. Women were kissing Pink's hands. Another fell on her knees and imitated performing fellatio on him as he sang. Others clung to him, thrusting their hips on his legs.
Audience interaction is an important part of the Imperial Orgy. During shows, Caeser invites women to bite from Satan's apple. He is always searching for a chance to kiss or caress a sensual woman. And during the song Exhibition, he carries a video camera which is projected onto a wide screen behind the band. As he sings, he films women in the audience who are urged to reveal their bodies to him and to the crowd of onlookers. All these elements combine to create a powerful force that impacts audiences deeply. This journal entry by a female fan describes the sometimes confused emotions stirred by Caeser's presence.
Why under such bizarre circumstances must I be pushed into my childhood with girl-like fear and lust? He never comes to me first when performing, but he comes. It's just a part of the show, I think in my head. It means nothing, but I love it. Rock and roll, nothing more. I mean nothing to him. And he must be entering my head at times because of his stage presence.
Soon after the Imperial Orgy began performing, the group became a stimulus for sexual exploration among their fans. Inspired by the orgy to explore their secret desires, normally inhibited people began to use sexuality as a means to find themselves and a sense of community. Some of the stories are both dramatic and humorous.
Because of audience interaction, fans sometimes imagine themselves to be having relationships with band members that don't really exist. There were two women in the early days who, after a show, were exploring lesbianism for the first time. In the middle of their lovemaking, each revealed to each other that they believed themselves to be having a relationship with Pink. Relationships which in reality did not exist. The irony is that these two lovers became so jealous and angry at each other about this that the lovemaking came to an abrupt end.
It's strange, celebrities become the receptors for people's dreams. They project onto you whatever they're looking for or lack in themselves. Sometimes when the possession takes me, it's very dramatic. It feels like I'm being wiped out as an individual and replaced by something universal. When I meet people after a show, I never really know whether they see me or the symbol. Sometimes each kiss can further wipe out the individual and give power to the universal which has taken me.
Audience members testify that Caeser's mix of openness about his own human vulnerability stimulates a feminine urge to nurture and protect, while his anything-goes confidence makes them feel a sense of acceptance, as if anything they do will be all right.
Our main goal is to create an environment where people can lose themselves in the moment and become one with the community. In the end, we use sexuality as a means to create a spiritual experience.
In the mechanized world of modern life, this union of sexuality and spirituality can be profound. Often, Imperial Orgy shows climax with the stage and dance floor transformed into a body-strewn petting orgy where strangers come together and do something all too rare in modern times. They touch each other.
And now, here's a film from Art Pig.
You're so young and beautiful, and I love you so. your eyes that shine, shame the stars that glow. So fill these lonely arms of mine and kiss me tenderly. Then you'll be forever young and beautiful to me. You're so young and beautiful. You're everything I love.
Years since the king of rock and roll passed into the great beyond. Well, I guess he's up there singing with the angels now. Of course, that goddamn atheist John Mertz would probably say that he just died and went into oblivion. Doesn't believe in the resurrection and the life after death. You know, I've had it with that guy shit about up to here.
Train a ride, 16 coaches long.
I only have one thing to say to you, buddy. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day again, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, from which he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen! Stick that in your peace pipe!
That's the stupidest thing I ever heard of, Brown. The Bible's full of shit, and I can prove it.
I dare you to try to prove it!
Look. If Adam and Eve were the only two humans on Earth, then their sons and daughters must have had sex in order to procreate the human race, right? Which means that God forced the human race to practice incest in order to exist. And yet Leviticus chapter 38 verse 23 specifically lists sex between brothers and sisters as a sin. That's a contradiction. And it's right at the beginning of the Bible, and it proves that the whole damn book is wrong.
Now we'll take you to the Imperial Orgy live on stage.